Harbor is that law and order have broken down in Detroit, Michigan.
There's something happening here. What it is ain't exactly clear. There's a man with a gun over there telling me I got to beware.
We're pulling up now at 14th and Davis, and they've got a searchlight up on third floor of a brick building.
I think this is the toughest situation to deal with that I've seen now, short of Vietnam.
As I saw the kind of people being brought into the police stations last night, they're the black have-nots of this country who have stored up more resentment than I or anybody else thought that they could store up. And it's coming out, and it's ugly, it's vicious, it's unfortunate.
Tonight marks the 20-year anniversary of what many consider a watershed in Detroit history, the start of the riot of 1967. It's been called the worst civil disorder in modern American history, a week of arson, looting, and murder. At least 43 people were killed, over 7,000 were arrested, and entire city blocks were left in ruin. Good evening, I'm Kathy Adams, and I'll be your host tonight as reporters Joe Weaver, Bill Gallagher, and Woody Willis look back at the events of two decades ago. We'll see what sparked the riot, what fanned the flames, and what ashes remain in the city's image. Joe Weaver begins with a look at some of the history behind what happened.
To understand what sparked the rage in 67, we have to look at the volatile climate of the decade. As the nation was learning the lessons of Vietnam, the schools became the battlefront at home.
We are required to defend freedom on a faraway battlefield that we did not choose, and we are busily attacking poverty in a war that we did choose.
The Great Society raised hopes that long-term injustices would finally be addressed. But those same hopes created frustration that change could not come soon enough. In 63, the March to Freedom on Woodward Avenue drew over 120,000, and Martin Luther King spoke at Cobo Hall.
That the Negro is now determined to be free.
But while King advocated peaceful disobedience, other black leaders urged more militant action.
We want black power! We want black power!
At the same time, the pent-up anger in the black ghettos exploded, first in Watts in 65, then in almost every other major city. Even so, Mayor Jerome Kavanaugh and many others here believe that Detroit would be spared.
As you recall, Detroit was held up, at least its city government, and the city itself is sort of a model of community relations among all the cities in the country. Everyone assumed that a riot could never happen here.
I was on the street in those days covering crime, politics, the controversies of the moment. I remember with what glowing terms the national press depicted Detroit. The New York Times praised the city as a model of economic development and race relations. Mayor Jerome Kavanaugh was recognized as one of the most progressive leaders in the country. He believed Detroit would become the most successful experiment of the Great Society.
I would want all of you to understand.
Jerry Kavanaugh was on his way for going to the White House. We had talked about sending Jerry to Washington as president. Well, we had a lot of respect for Mayor Kavanaugh. We worked our rear ends off to get him elected in 1961. The total black community worked to get him elected.
To many, Kavanaugh's election symbolized racial cooperation and how far the city had come, how much it had changed since the tragedy of 43.
1943, there was more or less a confrontation between blacks and whites. At that time, I was editor of a little journal called Racial Digest, and I think I said the month before that Detroit was a boiling pot that might explode at any time.
Well, I remember seeing the pictures of the main confrontations. There were some shootings on a streetcar, and cars were turned over and burned. Were you there then?
Yes, because I saw people coming out of the market, and I saw a fellow coming out with just a bottle of wine. And he just happened to come out at the time that a police car came around the corner. They just hopped out of the cars and just shot him down.
35 people died in the 43 riot. It ended only after FDR called in federal troops to restore order. After 43, attempts were made to improve the conditions that caused that riot. Some of the barriers of job and housing discrimination were broken down, and a significant black middle class emerged. In August of 66, Detroit was 33% black, and as a group, they earned more than their counterparts anywhere else in the country. But still, the toll of racism was high, and the signs of trouble were around the corner.
You got the feeling that something was wrong because the streets were literally deserted.
In what became known as the Kercheval incident, a patrol car was stoned. A hostile crowd confronted a police force resented in the black community. John Nichols was deputy superintendent.
And if I do say, if I do say so myself, it went down like a field problem. It went down like it should have gone down. Everything functioned. And I think that subconscious we may have said we got the answer to this. Well, we had the answer to a small problem. We just didn't have the answer to a massive problem.
We have heard a lot of charges going back that far of police brutality on the street. Of course, you were not on the street. You were a command officer. But what about those charges?
I don't think it was resentment any more against the police than it was against what many black people perceived as the entire weight of the white community coming down on them. And again, the police are up there, and they're the most visible, and they're the most active, and so we're going to get our share of the complaints.
White policemen looked at themselves as that thin white line that was going to keep the blacks in their place. Now, that was the prevailing attitude of the average white policeman, see? And the blacks resented it, just as anyone would resent that kind of attitude toward them.
Al Dunmore began reporting for the Michigan Chronicle in 63.
The police department was looked upon almost as an army of occupation who had no regards for the people that they were serving.
At random, they just go out and beat people up. And the tension in this town began to start building. Everybody was concerned about the police department in the city of Detroit.
Arthur Featherstone is a civil rights activist who was an aide for Congressman John Conyers. That office received thousands of complaints of police brutality in the years before the riot.
The Detroit police in the city of Detroit in 1967 was cold, vicious, and rotten. They are the root cause of the riot of 1967 in the city of Detroit. If you're going to single out any one entity, the Detroit police would be the one.
In the 10th Precinct, police-community relations were especially tense. This included the Virginia Park area, where the riot would erupt.
It was at that time the busiest police precinct in the world. There was a lot of action on 12th Street. At
a lot of street life, yeah. A lot of prostitution and gaming.
What you want, baby, I got
all night long. Oh, no, no.
It was, quote, unquote, the street.
I think you could count a bar, maybe one or two bars in every block.
12th Street wasn't that loud of a street, you know. Where they had real small sidewalks and, you know, this kind of thing.
There's very little left today of what was 12th Street two decades ago. Once this avenue was lined with businesses, including a number of blind pigs or after-hour bars. When the rest of the city went to sleep, that's when 12th Street came alive. And this sin strip ran through the heart of the most densely populated area of the city. urban renewal and highway construction had crowded many blacks into this neighborhood, while big sections of the city were silently closed to them.
This is a peculiar neighborhood, it was at that time. We were one of the first black families that moved into the area. In fact, we were the first ones that moved in on Lee Street, and at that time it was principally a Jewish neighborhood. Eventually, most of the white population has moved out of the area, and it's, I guess, by the time of the disturbance of the riot in 67, why it was principally a majority of blacks in the neighborhood. Prior to the riot, why conditions were of such a nature in this area because of the density of the population. We had landlords
apartments like this,
apartments like this that had divided them into two apartments, made two apartments out of one. It all led to perhaps an unnatural situation, which possibly contributed to a feeling of despair among the people, because there were 30,000 people in this congested area, maybe a square mile or more. And Carl Shrimp was right here on the corner, along with a little shoe store.
When we return, the story of the riot.
Burning places all up and down.
It wasn't a race riot. It was a fight, a confrontation.
Man, it wasn't no revolution, wasn't no black power, wasn't no money power.
Sometimes it haunts me, and I ask myself, why did this have to happen?
I'm still wondering today. Well, what's the message to it?
May 23rd, 1967. It was a very warm, muggy night, one of many such nights in a long, hot summer. At 3 o'clock Sunday morning, the blind pigs were just heating up. There was quite a party going on in the one above the Economy Printing Company on 12th and Claremont, a celebration for returning Vietnam vets. But unbeknownst to the revelers, two black undercover cops had made a buy and the cleanup crew was ready to raid. This would be the spark that ignited 6 days of burning and looting. Bill Gallagher chronicles what happened that week through the accounts of eyewitnesses.
Tempers were hot. It was a hot night, and people were out on the street.
And we always get fearful of hot nights because everybody gets to be restless. The police get to be tense. The guy out on the street.
It seemed a lot of tension. And that's a good way of putting it. Tension is, what it was.
Ooh, how long will it take for a crowd? Maybe about a second. Okay, I was on the Claremont bus. We was going to 12. It was about 3:30 in the morning. I walked the street all night. I'm not just talking 12, 1 o'clock. I'm talking about 3 and 4 o'clock in the morning. They used to call me the Nighthawk.
Charlie Henry and Joe Brown just drove up in a cleanup car. Well, Charlie says, the reason we're asking you guys is because we got the buy already. And, The crowd is just so lively in there. I mean, it's basically a young crowd, and looked like they may be some trouble. We had this one guy who had the axe, and he started to hit the bottom door. And bam, 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 like that. So I grabbed this ram myself, and I just threw the thing in the door, and the door fell down and he started upstairs. I'm the only guy in uniform that was going up there, and I was the first one. So I grabbed the guy with the bald head and I kind of threw him down the stairs. So we entered, and everyone seemingly was at the back of the room. So I escorted myself personally, everyone into the paddyway. They were on the apartment building across the street, and They were throwing bricks and bottles, and I'm like, wow, what? You know.
And I heard him, get the pigs, get the pigs. Because they, at first, they talk about it was Black Panther militant. You know, they try to throw it off on black and white.
So I see a scout car pull up in the intersection of Claremont and 12th, which was the traffic light and what have you there. Saw this guy get out, and bam, he got hit right in the head, a police officer, with a bottle. You know, he goes down, and I'm going, wow, what the heck is going on here?
And then some, everybody started breaking in and stuff. One of these people, about 20 of them, they were shaking the bars of the pawn shop, just shaking them, shaking them. I say, don't go over there. I say, the police gonna come. He told me, don't worry about the police. We got the police under control.
There were 9 there at that time. Well, I mean, I've never seen so many people in my life with things.
Unfortunately, it's warm Sunday afternoon or Sunday morning. A lot of policemen are not available for duty. And I think the most cogent remark of the whole riot was made to me by a very young policeman on 12th Street who said, boss, he said, they mobilized faster than we did.
Kids got cops going up and down the streets, got 3 and 4 baskets of food. They say, you better go get you something instead of standing around looking like you're crazy because you're not gonna be able to buy nothing in Detroit. I said, oh Lord, I went. So I filled up me a cart, loaded it up.
What's that?
Several people begin to show up at headquarters, prominent people from the black community.
Secret Service, the entire law enforcement network.
The biggest debate they had was trying to decide whether they should shoot the looters. When that decision was made, the mayor and the police said no.
I asked one of them, I said, look, I said, can't we do something about this? I said, because they're going to tear up our city. In my opinion, if they had let the police department handle it in their way, the thing would have been stopped within, I'll say, a couple of hours.
As far as shooting, if anybody had shot out there, it would have been carnage. It would have been carnage. And once you drop one, you'd have had to drop them all. And I don't think there was enough of us to win.
And so the congressman got up on the car system to get up on the car with the bullhorn. He said, well, you know, we're out here to try to see if we can keep this thing under control. We don't want to have the same thing happen in our city like happened in Cleveland and Watts, Newark, and various other places around the country.
Congressman Conyers, he tried. They had to get him out of there before they popped him upside the head with a bottle. Because, you know, they didn't want to hear that.
The overwhelming majority of the Negro community is stunned, shocked, and dismayed by the lawlessness of a very small percentage of people and youngsters that have brought this holocaust upon this city.
They just start burning places all up and down, going up and down the avenue, throwing rocks, knocking out windows, looting. All the blacks that had business in the community, they put blood, they wrote blood, soul brother. If you had soul brother, they wouldn't burn your place. But that was nonsense because the fire didn't discriminate.
Now, why should they set the places on fire after everything's gone out of the places? This is senseless.
Do you see any racial overtones to this at all?
No, I don't, because I can see just as many white as I can see colored taking things out of the stores.
All of the violence was against property, not against individuals. There were very few, if any, cases where blacks attacked white people, per se. But they did attack property, which they thought was symbolic of the institutions against which they were rebelling.
Man, wasn't no revolution, wasn't no black power, wasn't no money power. It was just looting power.
I flew over the area in a helicopter when I saw the fires all over that vast area, like a battlefield. Of course, the minute I arrived, I became the one responsible for handling the situation.
Governor,
since the last time we talked to you, we've called up the full National Guard. We've closed the encampment in Grayling, and we should have by tomorrow morning about 6,000 to 7,000 National Guardsmen here, as well as the additional state police and, of course, the full Detroit Police Department. Now, I think all of these men who are already on the streets are doing a tremendous job, but particularly the firefighters of Detroit.
We fought fires different than we ever did before. We'd knock down fires, but we wouldn't be able to stay right there and put them out until the last ember was out. You know, we couldn't do that. We'd just keep moving, moving, moving.
Break it down!
We'd pull up to fight a fire, and they'd start throwing bottles and bricks at you, and it got so bad that I just had to tell the men to retreat and don't try to fight the people, just call for police protection.
Return to your home.
283 times we had to retreat from a fire till protection got there to help us.
We just didn't think it was going to happen. It took our breath away. You know, we were just stunned. Because, you know, if someone's house caught on fire, you expect for the fire department to come and put it out. Like I said, by the time they did get here to put the fire out, several houses they got burnt down. And not several, 14, maybe 14 homes. They said the riot was because of black people didn't like the way they were being treated and stuff, but it was, you know, white people didn't set the fire. It was black people did this to us. You know, we just so astonished, amazed, you know.
Why would they do that to us?
Why would they do that to us, you know?
By midnight or a little thereafter, it was obvious it was a very serious situation, and one that would probably be beyond the ability of the city and the state on a combined basis to control.
And that's why we decided at 2:30 Monday morning that we had to have at least 5,000 federal troops in order to deal with the situation. And we worked consistently and without any vacillation on the part of either of us to get those troops here and to get them out on the streets.
I guess about the middle of the morning, they called and indicated that they would give us some federal assistance and that Vance would be sent out representing the president to help handle the situation.
A visit to various areas around the city. On the whole, things appear to be relatively quiet.
But Vance and Throckmorton were not willing to get the troops out on the streets. I think Cyrus Vance was taking orders from President Johnson, and I think Johnson at that time was concerned about me. I was ahead in the polls. I was a possible opponent, presidential opponent. And so I think it played a very important part.
Mr. Vance, General Throckmorton, and others were in Detroit and in conference with Governor Romney by the middle of this afternoon.
As a matter of fact, when he went on the air later that evening, after the decision had been made to put the troops on the streets, I think he went out of his way to try and place the blame on me. Well, the only part I'd had in the situation was to try and stop it. I hadn't been involved in it occurring, and I hadn't been involved in anything other than trying to deal with it.
I'm sure that the American people will realize that I take this action with the greatest regret and only because of the clear, the unmistakable, and the undisputed evidence that Governor Romney of Michigan and the local officials in Detroit have been unable to bring the situation under control.
I think the President of the United States played politics in a period of tragedy and riot.
And I'm convinced that that period of delay resulted in the riot running an extra day. I think it could have been stopped earlier if they'd have done what they were willing to do in Newark and what they subsequently established as a policy, namely when a governor asked for help, to give him the help.
Apparently, when the snipe broke there, everybody was gone.
The only unit, Smart Team 1.
Even though they got the federal troops out on the street, the National Guards people were in the places where the intense conflict was going on, and the federal troops weren't in those areas.
there you are with live ammunition, and you're concerned for your own welfare, and plus you're scared. We was not down there to kill anybody. We was down there strictly to help restore law and order only.
Behind two tanks and at least 200 guardsmen, maybe more, and they've got a searchlight up on the third floor of a brick building.
It was just like a war. And I'd never seen a war like that with little kids, women, mothers. I just seen wars with men on men. Not little innocent, you know, bystanders, so it was really rough. I remember a little boy got killed. He was looting in the store. And the boy had a little plastic gun. And he had some potato chips and a donut. And his National Guard, he was white. He was crying. He said, "I didn't mean to do it. I didn't mean to do it."
The National Guard was mean and evil. They did a lot of the shooting and the murdering.
It was a hot summer night. The demonstration wagon, there was five of us in there. And when we just received to the house where my brother lived at.
This was after curfew?
It was after curfew. And I was riding down Gladwin here, and as we were approaching Mac, all of a sudden, I heard a noise said, "Stop." So when I stopped, a guard ran out in front of me, and there was a gun in my face. And he told me, I explained to him what was going on, and he said, "Oh, okay, you can't go this way, and you can't take your brother across here because the barricade here."
So you did exactly what they told you?
I did exactly what the guards told me to do, and I took right on off. And as I was going along the street here, I noticed the guards and everything was down the other end of the street. It was quiet, it wasn't no shooting or nothing. And then as I was turning to Lancaster here, as my lights hit the side, I seen a Jeep sitting on the
right
corner.
Here?
Yes, and I stopped right here. At the particular time, all the shots rang out into the car. It looked like they continued to shoot the car, and I kept hollering out, "Hey, stop shooting. We ain't did nothing. We stopped shooting," and I was on the floor. So I took my hand and I reached with my right hand and opened the door.
So what happened when you fell out in the street here?
Well, I laid there helpless, and I was asking for help. And I was asking how was everybody else, you know. And during a particular time, we was rushed down to the hospital. I didn't know my friend was dead until after about a week and a half.
It was John Leroy.
That's John Leroy, and he was my next door neighbor. He was a very good friend of mine.
Four people were seriously wounded, one was dead.
Really? And it's a hurting thing.
For what?
For you being in the hospital and you wake up and you find out your best buddy is dead too. And that's a hurting thing because it was just a simple little run just to drop my brother off at the house and back home. Sometimes it haunts me, and I ask myself, why did this have to happen?
With your lights out. Approach the area with your lights out. Clear at 10:32.
Most of the people who were doing the shooting were law enforcement people of some sort. In the work that went on after the riot, we took weeks and investigated all of the 43 deaths, and we couldn't find any of them that were attributable for sure to sniper fire. I think most everybody feels that the one thing that they might have done differently is not bring in the National Guard.
Our troops were well disciplined. We had a good command and control of our personnel, but there was a few police officers, in my estimation, that were out just to kill people. And they used this as justification to eliminate what they considered to be the problem in the area.
After the bodies of the three murdered men had been found here at the Algiers Annex, witnesses reported
the police were still there investigating. And I went over to the Algiers Motel. And these kids were shot at point-blank range with riot shotguns. Point-blank range. Flesh was blown into the wall. Pieces of flesh was all over the place. Debris, blood, you name it. Young bodies.
And a couple of my friends just wanted to have a nice time. I don't know what laid in the room.
The police had seen three white females and three blacks going in. They was getting their refreshments and things. They were going to have a party during the night. And the police say they heard some shooting coming out of the motel.
It was the first situation we'd had where supposed snipers had been shot and killed, and there were three of them. So we went out and took a look at the Algiers, and the thing physically didn't make sense in terms of where the people had been killed, what evidence there was of an exchange of, you know, gunfire.
The police wanted an excuse to get in that motel, so they said somebody was shooting out of the motel, snipers. You know, a member of the police department in 1967 seeing young guys with white girls from Ohio, just in the middle of the black community, it still didn't set too well with them. And they say, hey, we're going to deal with this situation. And they did.
See, I blocked that out of my mind. And I always block it out of my mind. Because I don't even want to, you know, deal with those kind of folks. Because if they did it once, they'll do it again.
Murder.
That's right. Murder.
We didn't find, apart from the Algiers, we didn't find a situation in which we thought that somebody particularly guilty had gone unpunished.
Let's go, buddy. Get out of the way. Let's go.
The police started the riot, and the police ended it.
I was proud of Detroit. You know, I was proud I was a police officer. I was proud of the city. I didn't want to see these things. I didn't want to see it burn like this.
Today, I look back on what have happened. It was incredible. A beautiful city had to get destroyed just to get what kind of message across. I'm still wondering today, what was the message to it?
Of the 67 riot. It's been said that for this generation, no single event has affected Detroit more. On this block, almost every house was set on fire and only a few are found today. But the neighborhood itself was lost. It may never come back, like so many others. Perhaps it's simply a grim legacy. Greater white flight, heightened fears and hatred, businesses that left. But other things came of it too. Changes in the police force and in the political arena. Woody Willis looks at the aftermath.
In the long run, we didn't accomplish anything. We burned up half of Detroit. We got vacant lots to show for it now. Well, they did have houses, but what did we do? We burned up our own self.
Entire blocks have been leveled by fire, and pockets of destruction exist throughout the city. Losses due to fire and looting have been estimated at hundreds of millions of dollars. And these estimates may well prove to be conservative.
Do
This is the 2400 block of Pingree between Linwood and LaSalle. Sunday night, 11 homes were burned out, leaving the other side of the block intact. Do you think it can ever happen again in Detroit?
Well, I do. I really do. I think that there may be a time after this, a so-called complacency. If nothing happens, and it'll happen again, it may take another 20 years, but I doubt if it'll take this long again, because the people here, they have nothing at all now. And then when you have nothing, you can't lose anything.
The disturbing sounds and sheer fury of 1967 proved to be a sobering experience, if not a rude awakening. The crystal ball idealism reflected in the statement "it could not happen here" was shattered by the harsh reality of alienation, and later the admission that some of us did not know each other very well.
Our community has been torn apart. We have spent years trying to build bridges, and then to have persons just come in and in a few hours to destroy this is a little bit more than some of us can take.
There was a desperate need for dialogue between the movers and shakers and those who felt they were usually moved and shaken. New Detroit Incorporated was conceived as the vehicle that would bring the captains of industry into direct contact with the grassroots.
The original New Detroit Committee was really supposed to be a two-week committee. And here we are in 1987, still in business.
Paul Hubbard has been senior vice president of New Detroit Incorporated for the last 13 years.
Is New Detroit a forum for the major corporations offering only limited reforms?
If people are not rioting because they are pacified with some of the things that they want in the area of housing and food and education and a car or a job training, then I don't think that's bad.
To the extent that we've not had a repetition of that conduct, they can claim some success. To the extent that they made a commitment to materially assist in the process of self-determination as the mode of rebuilding this city, I'd have to say that they were an abysmal failure.
In its 20-year history, New Detroit has helped create many important social programs, but it has been unable to promote the economic development necessary to offset the decline of Detroit's industrial base. That decline began decades before 67, but the riot hastened the fall.
Detroit's wealth was based on its factories all over the city. At its peak, Detroit had a manufacturing job base alone of about 400,000. The base now is probably about 100,000. Industry found many reasons to close their plants in Detroit and open elsewhere. The exodus of jobs was followed by the exodus of people and the exodus of more jobs, because with the flight of the middle class from Detroit to the suburbs, retailers found it very easy pickings in the suburbs.
This was a nice neighborhood. The schools was convenient, churches, and the shoppings. We had bakeries, we had laundries, we had hardware, we had a combination of tents and stores, like buy everything.
Cleaners.
We had a big market.
Anything that you really need.
Most anything that a homeowner would like.
After the riots, the neighborhood changed. A lot of places were destroyed, businesses were destroyed. But, and then some people were not able to rebuild. What you would see then were, you know, a lot of black people, because we didn't have a lot of white in the area. A lot of them, some of them stayed, but not all. I think they became frightened. And I know one or two families moved to Warren.
One of the things that happened after 1967 was a sharp drop in the value of real estate, particularly residential real estate. And I think that many whites saw this as a good time to leave. So they took their lumps, took their losses, and moved to the suburbs.
White flight to the suburbs began in the late 1940s. The unexpected 67 upheaval heightened fears, accelerating the process. The most damaging aspect of flight, as far as the city was concerned, involved business owners and managers, most of whom were white. By the 1970s, middle-income blacks, taking advantage of open housing opportunities, also began to move out. Despite the trend, Detroit remains the most segregated major metropolitan area in the country.
Perhaps one of the nice things about white flight is that it turns over the city to a black political constituency. The riot may have accelerated the inclusion and acceptance and finally conversion of the Detroit establishment from white without any real black influence to black with some white influence.
We have many problems. We have many challenges.
I knew for a certainty that in order to bring some peace to this city, the next mayor had to control the police department. The police department could not be allowed to be a law unto itself. There wasn't a race riot. It was a fight, a confrontation between blacks and the police department. And of course, it developed into a confrontation between blacks and the whole damn military police establishment.
Riot, I think, more than anything else, is a major, major chapter in the life of the city of Detroit, because what happened after that riot, I think, really helped change this place from an occupation army to a place where the police department became a part of the city and not a force that was controlling the city.
Elliot Hall was the first law director for Mayor Young. He drafted a plan to bring racial equality to a police force that was 93% white in 1967.
Once the affirmative action program in the Detroit Police Department was able to get moving, and we saw an increase in the number of black police officers in the patrol level, plus sergeants, lieutenants, and upper command officers, then you began to see the real change in the city of Detroit.
We've got thousands of signatures from people inside of the city of Detroit who have called for the abolition of stress.
What an aroused black community clearly saw as police brutality in 1967 became a political rallying cry by 1973. Under Mayor Roman Gribbs, the police department formed a highly controversial decoy unit. The aggressive street enforcement concept was appropriately called stress.
The police broke into my mother's home Monday evening without a search warrant, broke the door down, put guns on me, my baby brother, who is 2 years old.
And it was stress and the resentment of stress and its murderous tactics, and they were murderous, that united black people in this city and in their determination to get a new mayor.
With the election of Coleman Young and a number of other key black public officials, optimism bordered on euphoria. Expectations based on that success, however, soon ran headlong into near catastrophic reverses in the private sector. The 1973 Middle East oil embargo spelled instant obsolescence for American gas-guzzling cars and the plants producing them. Fuel-efficient foreign cars quickly filled the vacuum. Outmoded factories were abandoned. Unimagined layoffs hit our steel and auto workers. At ground level, the real tragedy was and is the crushing disillusionment of a dream deferred.
When you look at the plants who have moved out of the city, you look at the plants that are closed, that was there, the jobs that was there for blacks after the 1967 disturbance, opposed to what we have today. That's the frightening thing. And when you look at the unemployment situation in terms of the population of this city, it has dwindled from the 50s, which was a high of 1.9 million. Today, it's 1.2 million, and 60% of that total population is on a fixed income. Those youngsters who would have been 16, 18, and 20 years old, most of them never had a job in their life. We're going to lose too many young black minds. And I shudder to think, if that happened, what will happen to the next black generation, you know, in this country?
Mother, mother, there's too many of you crying. Brother, 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 there's far too many of you dying.
Some sociologists see the ongoing random youth violence as a controlled riot rooted in despair. The availability of cheap illegal handguns and ever-increasing amounts of illegal imported narcotics can make a child's mistake fatal. Law-abiding citizens who began arming themselves in 1967 continue to do so in an even greater climate of fear.
Made us much more suspicious of each other than had been, you know, I think we all thought we were moving along the path, and suddenly it scared the heck out of a lot of people.
After the riot, really for true, that's when people begin to start getting bars and burglar alarms and having dogs like we got. And people started getting more security.
Because the neighborhood had changed.
It was changing.
One of the greatest changes after the riot was how others perceived the city and how Detroiters perceived themselves. The image of a young, dynamic Mayor Jerome Kavanaugh destined for national office. The image of a progressive city with exemplary race relations all went up in smoke. Justified or not, reporters, local and out of town, used Detroit to symbolize decaying neighborhoods and rampant crime. If the news media is a mirror in which we see ourselves, then the reflection, indeed the complexion of it, has changed considerably, directly as a result of the 67 explosion.
We had enough black reporters in 1967 to cover the riots, but we didn't have any black editors in 1967. Now that's changed. We do have black editors, and you know, a number of the top editors of this newspaper, and this newsroom right, you know, here.
As the community surveyed the scars of that long hot summer, the announcement of plans for a gleaming Renaissance center on the riverfront seemed a godsend. It was the glistening brainchild of Henry Fourth II, and although it took a decade of overcoming impossible obstacles, it is now the most recognized symbol of the city's hope.
See, there are people who choose to ignore the mammoth positive changes that have taken place in the city. Go down 12th Street. It's now Rosa Parks Boulevard. Everything over there is brand new. We've survived. A whole lot of people didn't think we'd last this long. But we're moving forward. The direction is up, it's not down. Do we have a big fight on our hands? Sure, but what's new? We've always had to fight to get what we deserved. And we're still fighting and we're still getting it.